Hi, and welcome to Tiger Art. Today we're going to talk about one of my favorite artistic styles, Surrealism. Look at the word Surrealism. See if there's anything you recognize or you think you might know about this before we really get started. Sometimes I have students suggest that it might have something to do with pictures that look really real. And my question to that would be, wouldn't that be realism? So surrealism means there has to be something else going on. Let's look at some pictures and try to form our idea of surrealism that way. I couldn't mention surrealism without mentioning probably the most well-known surrealist, and his name was Salvador Dali. Salvador Dali painted this picture. This is probably his most famous one. This is called The Persistence of Memory. What do we notice about it? It looks kind of believable, like a desert landscape, but there are some things in it that don't make much sense. So we have like melting clocks. Well, that's kind of weird. That's not something we would normally see. Clocks are made of like solid plastic or metal or glass or something that would be hard. And these appear to be soft and kind of melting and dripping. So that's unusual. What else do we notice? There's like this weird looking rock thing that kind of looks like a head facing down. That's pretty strange too. That's unusual. Let's look at another Dali painting and see if we notice anything else unusual. So for this picture, we notice that these elephants appear to be made out of bone or stone or something, and they have really long legs. So in surrealism, you may see things that look strange, but also we could be more specific and say exaggerations of size. So things that would appear way bigger or way smaller than they should in the real world. Here's another Dali painting where he paints the clock again, but here it's stretching so much that it's boom, it's just exploding. So you might see an object that's exploding into little fragments that are kind of flying in the air. Here's another example of that. So we see what looks like the interior of a domed building, and it's kind of made up of all of these swirling around particles of like this head. That's definitely something interesting. Here's another one that's kind of like that. This is a portrait of Dali's wife. Her name was Gala. And here he has built her portrait out of these floating spheres. So when you look at these floating spheres from one specific point of view, you can see it make the image of his wife. But really, when you look at it closely, it's just a bunch of spheres that are different colors and shapes, or different colors and patterns on them that are in a specific arrangement. Okay, here's another desert landscape by Dali, but this brings about some other questions. Something in here appears a bit strange, like it looks like kind of something. Look at it for a second and then tell me if you can see the face. Okay, well, it's not really a face. What it is a person sitting facing away from you, sitting on the ground. Tell me if you see the cup. Okay, well, it's not really a cup. It's just a hole, you know, a gap between those mountains. And then it kind of, it looks like the stem of a glass. And then the base is kind of where the person is sitting on the ground. Tell me if you see the dog. Check out the shape of the mountains, the way they curl around, and then they come up around to the top, and then there's a hole in the mountain with something far off in the distance that looks like the dog's eye. And then there's some water there, and there's a bridge going across it with the reflection of the bridge in the water underneath, and that makes it look like the dog's collar. But really, we could look at this picture and just think, all of it kind of makes sense. You know, it could just be a scene outdoors in the desert where all these things are just placed in the right spot, just right, to look like these hidden images. Here's an excellent example of hidden images from an old postcard drawing. When we look at this, we see two people sitting at a table. So you see one guy, and he's kind of going like this, and there's glasses on the table, and you know, they're sitting in front of a window. Everything appears to be just a normal scene. So that's what this is a picture of. But what does it look like? The way that the shapes come together makes the hidden image of a skull. That's pretty cool. Here's another one by Dali. This is a portrait of Mae West, who was a famous woman back in Dali's time. And when we look at this picture, what is a picture of? It's not actually a picture of her at all. So most artists would make a portrait, a picture of a person, and they would start by drawing or painting the person. He does it kind of backwards. He draws a room that makes the hidden image of the person. That's the surrealist way of doing this, or that's Dali's surrealist way of doing this. So the curtains in the doorway kind of look like her hair. The couch there kind of looks like her lips. There's like a fireplace or something with a clock on top of it that looks like her nose. And then there's two landscape pictures on the wall back there that look like her eyes. Here's another artist. His name is M.C. Escher. And he is a very, very smart, very mathematical, creative, wonderfully talented artist. He was excellent at making mathematical shapes that fit together like pieces of a puzzle, and he could draw illusions like this one that just bend your mind and they make your brain hurt. If you've seen The Night at the Museum 3, you have seen M.C. Escher's drawings, especially this one. This staircase drawing shows multiple realities in the same picture. So you can see when you're working in surrealism that you're not limited by what is real and what is possible. So you're making these imaginary and impossible structures. That's what M.C. Escher was really, really good at. I love this picture, because every time I look at it, I think I see something that makes sense. There'll be like a person standing on a floor, but then you look a little bit to the side and you'll notice that that floor is actually a wall for somebody else. So somebody else's reality is going in a different direction. Very cool. Here's another M.C. Escher drawing. This one shows the hands that are coming out of the page and drawing each other. So the hands are so realistic that they can actually come out of the drawing and then draw the other side. So it's kind of like a chicken and the egg thing, like which one came first? Did the hands get drawn first, or did the hands make the drawing? So which one had to happen first? And it's that kind of questions that you would ask that makes this more interesting. Here's another artist, a Belgian surrealist named René Magritte. And with his paintings, we start to see some other things in surrealism. Often in surrealism, we may see things that look dreamlike, or things where we take one thing and we put it somewhere else. That's called juxtaposition. And juxtaposition is just that. You're taking something, you're putting it where it doesn't belong. Think like position means where something is. So juxtaposition is where you take something and you're juxtaposing it. You're putting it in a position somewhere else. So like taking the clouds in the sky and putting them into the iris of an eyeball. Here we have kind of a hidden image where there's like this missing ship and it's kind of carved into the clouds. Or you could think of it as the boat is made out of water. So in surrealism, you may see things that are made out of a material that they wouldn't normally be made out of. What's the key word we think of here? Exaggerations of size. Making something much, much bigger than you think it should be. Could you make this in real life? How would you do it easily? If it were me and I was just had a camera, and I was trying to take a picture of something that looked just like this, what if I put an apple in a dollhouse? There we go. There's our surrealist picture. So if you're creative, you can think of ways to do this stuff and make it real, even though it's completely impossible. This last one shows a very important aspect of surrealism called metamorphosis. Metamorphosis means to change form. So one thing that changes into another, like a caterpillar that goes through a metamorphosis and changes into a butterfly. So when we're making hidden images in surrealism, it's often helpful to make it kind of look like it first. So there's clouds that start to kind of make this shape. And then for the big one, where it really, they want it to look like a hot air balloon, the cloud really takes on that shape. But it's the first one that's next to it that kind of shows how it's changing from a cloud into the finished hot air balloon. So what are some things we think of with surrealism. Surrealism is pictures that are strange or unusual. They look like they could be real because they're realistically drawn or painted, but they may include impossible objects, so things that are floating or things that just make no sense, like an M.C. Escher staircases. You could also see metamorphosis, where one thing's changing form into something else. You may see objects that are made out of different materials than they normally would be, like a boat made out of water, or elephants made of stone. You will also see exaggerations of size, things that are way bigger or way smaller, hidden images, so like a landscape with items in certain places that make the appearance of a person or a dog. With surrealism, we also see objects that are melting or bending. Things like that are common in Dali paintings, and that's what we think of. This is Salvador Dali. He's one of my favorite artists because he's just so strange. His paintings were so unusual, you don't forget them when you see them. Look at his mustache. That's one thing that he's very well known for. The big waxed mustache. That's classic Dali. Okay, so for today, for this surrealist project, we're going to be learning how to draw some shapes like Salvador Dali's clock. And we'll keep it pretty simple. We'll do a little bit of drawing and some coloring on this project. So you're going to need a piece of paper and a pencil for today's part. I would suggest using the paper going up and down. However, if you wanted it to be side to side, I would understand if your clock was going to be a little bit wider and kind of more melted and laying flat. Either way is fine with me. So just a few pointers, general drawing tips. When you're holding your pencil for drawing, you want to hold it up a little higher, away from the tip, and you want to loosen your grip. That will allow you to both see your whole picture as you're drawing, like your hand won't be covering up your picture, so you can see the whole thing, and also it's going to allow you to control the pressure much better. So you don't want to be drawing lines like this, because you might be trying to draw a clock shape, and if you don't like the way that looks, you're kind of out of luck. All you can do is really flip the paper over or get a new piece of paper, because you're not going to be able to erase that line. What I would suggest doing is keeping it loose and light and holding it up here and kind of coming up with an idea of what you want this clock shape to look like. It can be pretty weird and out there. You know, this is surrealism. That's totally okay. So you can also make changes to it if it's light. So you'd be able to erase stuff. Like, I don't usually like things the first time I draw them out, so I almost always change things quite a bit. So you could spend a couple of minutes just trying to get this right. Once you think you got a shape that you really like, then you want to go in and be a bit more exact. Now, you don't need to totally destroy the paper by pushing as hard as you can with the pencil, but just getting a bit more darker so that you can see the line better. That's fine. I'm only darkening certain spots. Spots where I want to add more weight to the line, like here where it feels like it's dripping and being pulled down. Okay. Now, you want to think about something. Think about this. If we had a standard clock and it was a circle, the center would be right in the center. All of the numbers would be 12, 6, 3, 9. They would be evenly spaced. They'd be exactly in the right spot. They'd all be the same size. You know, they would look like this two would look like this two. Everything would be exact. The hands on the clock, there's one long hand and there's one shorter hand. So if this, and that points to the hours, and the longer one points to minutes. So this would be like 5 o'clock because it's no minutes at 12 and the hour hand is at the 5. So that's like what a normal clock would look like. but this is not a normal clock. The clock has been melted and morphed into this interesting, organic, surreal-looking shape. So my center might not be right where it was originally. It might be like off to the side or somewhere else. So I'm going to move it according to what I think might have happened to it. So this kind of melted away, but the center drifted over this way. Totally fine. Nobody can tell me that that's wrong, because we don't know exactly how this clock would melt, because I've never seen a melting clock in real life. I've only seen them in paintings. All right, so now I can figure out where my numbers are going to go. This is the basic where numbers would be, but this is not the basic shape. So I can still start with the 12. That's probably still going to be up at the top unless my clock got twisted around. So you can do something kind of like this, but make your numbers, you know, stretched out and kind of cool looking. Give yourself some space. You know, if I was going to draw a ring around this clock outside of it, if you wanted to leave some space on the inside, like if you're already close to the edge, you may want to leave a little bit of space here. But I know I want the face of my clock to go all the way up to that edge. So I got the 12. Another easy one to put in would be 3. Now 3 would usually be in the middle, but you know, this could be the middle, this could be the middle. It all depends on how this melted and stretched. So I'm actually going to put the middle down a bit. I'm going to go like this. I'm going to put it over here. Now that 3 has been significantly stretched as the clock has melted. The 9 and the 6 would be the other two that are easy to place. Okay, once your numbers are complete, then we need to put in the hands and then like the outside edge. So this shouldn't really be even either, because if the clock is melting and this is stretching, it's going to make this outer ring thinner in some spots. And then other spots, it's going to pool up and collect, like down here, where this is all getting pushed together. I would imagine that that ring is also going to collect down there. All right, once you've got that done, you're gonna wanna take a picture of this and submit it to today's assignment. But don't lose this, because next week, we're gonna be starting some color with it. So keep this drawing, do not lose it. Take a picture of it and submit it, but don't lose it. All right, have fun. Make something that looks weird and totally surreal.